Luke 17, verses 31 and 32, the Bible tells us, "In that day, he which shall be upon the housetop, and his stuff in the house, let him not come down to take it away. And he that is in the field, let him likewise not return back." In verse 32, it says, "Remember Lot's wife." Remember Lot's wife. And may the Lord add a blessing to the hearers and to the doers of His word. Let us pray together this morning once more as we invite the presence of the Lord. Father in heaven, we now come to the sacred hour of this day. This whole day is sacred, but now is the sacred hour. And so, Father, we ask for your blessings to be bestowed upon each one who are in this room, those who will be watching. And may your Spirit penetrate our hearts and our mind so that we might be able to understand your word. Father, I pray as for me, I have nothing to share. I have nothing to offer. So therefore, I ask that you'd please anoint me with the Holy Spirit so that the words that I speak may not be my own, may come from the very throne of grace, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. There is a book written in 1984. It's called The Book of Love. It was a compilation of romantic trivia and short stories. And there was a story in there that really captivated my mind. It tells a young man, a young Taiwanese man, who went to a party, met a young girl, and they started talking that evening. They got to know each other, and they started laughing, and they started, you know, just connecting. What a beautiful relationship that evening. And his name was Ming. Ming was a Taiwanese young man who met this young lady in this party. And for Ming, when he saw Lee, it was love at first sight. It was love at first sight. The two together, they started spending time for the next year. Every single weekend, they were together. They went out. They would go and did everything. They went to the movies. They went to the park. They went to museum. They went to tours and restaurants and many places. And one evening, they went into a romantic place where Ming got down with one knee and he proposed and said, "Will you marry me?" To his surprise, the young lady said, "No, I am not ready to get married," and walk away. Heartbroken, yet hopeful that he can continue to win the affection of the young lady that he loved, Ming started writing letters every single day, 6 to 7 times a week, and he sent it to the woman of his dream. And every day he wrote, and he didn't hear back from this young lady. And so he increased his writing. He would write 3 times a day in a 24 hour. And the mailman would take this mail and deliver it to the front door and knock on the door and give it to the young lady with a smile. Every single day it happens. And for the next 2 years, Ming continued to write his love letter to the dream of his life, this young lady. And it totaled about 700 letters for 2 years. And finally, Ming got a response. And Lee said, "Now I am ready to get married." However, Lee didn't get married to Ming. Instead, she married the mailman that delivered the message every single day, consistently for the past 2 years. What a plot, what a twist of the story. I feel bad for the young man, Ming, who wrote 700 letters. But yet, at the end of the day, it was that personal contact with the mailman that impressed the young lady. And finally, she said, I am ready to get married. But she married not Ming, but she married the mailman. You see, friend, that teaches a lesson. Number one, if you do your job consistently, you're going to be rewarded. Amen? Either if you're a mailman, a janitor, a preacher, or accountant, or a teacher, one, when you do your job consistently with smile, you're going to be rewarded. The mailman was rewarded because he was consistent in the way he delivered the message every single day. You see, our message today is called The Wife to Remember, a study that shows the deadly effect of a person's inconsistent life and continue to compromise the principle of God's Word. Remember this, friends. An inconsistent person will ruin friendship and relationship. What did I say? An inconsistent person will ruin what? Friendship and relationship. This is why it's important to be consistent with our walk with the Lord. Because consistency will be rewarded. Amen? Just like the mailman. He was rewarded because he was consistent in doing his job. You see, friends, we are living in the last day. And it is important, especially for us, to be consistent and believe and do the truth that we profess. Because we know that we are living in the last day. And speaking of the last day, Jesus gave us some outline. In the book of Matthew 24 and in the book of Luke chapter 17, Jesus gave us some outline of what to expect for in the last days. And Jesus gave us different lists of the sign of his approaching return. So notice, Matthew 24, Jesus is speaking and he's telling the conditions of the world. He's giving the condition to the world to his disciples. Jesus is telling them in this context, Matthew 24 and Luke 17. Jesus is telling them what will happen in the end days. Jesus described the political scenario, the arena, and he says that it will be messy. Jesus described the condition in the natural world and that there would be natural disaster. Fires and flood and hurricane and tornadoes all around the globe will continue to happen with intensity. So Jesus continued to describe the economic recession and economic crisis that one day money would be worthless and they will be thrown in the streets. And Jesus continued to describe the spiritual condition of this world, both the church as well as the world. Then finally, Jesus described the social condition and family units in the end time. So we're going to go into the book of Luke 17. Just pay attention in the book of Luke 17, verse 26 to 32. I'm not going to read the whole thing because it's kind of long, but I want you to take it down, write it down, because I want you to go back and study it yourself. You see, friends, in this chapter, Luke chapter 17, verses 26 to 32, Jesus tells us the condition not just of the family of the world, but the family in the church. Amen? So, Jesus gives us a story. He gives us two examples of two families. How many families? We're going to go over with one of the family today. So, he gives us two examples of two families. He gives us Noah's family. And he also gives us whose family? Lot's family. That's right. Lot's family. So out of these two examples, by the way, there's a great contrast between these two examples. I just want you to notice now. Look at the screen for me. Noah's day versus Lot's day. I just want you to pay attention. It says there that during the days of Noah, the conditions of the world were wicked. It was an irredeemable age. And then we find also that in the days of Lot, it was wicked and the city was without hope. Then we find that the days Noah entered the ark, what happened next? Destruction came. And then when Lot when out of the city, destruction came, fire came. It's two examples that's kind of a little bit opposite exactly what happened. And then we find that the world was destroyed by the universal flood. Amen? Lot's day, it was destroyed by what? By fire. So one destroyed by flood, one destroyed by fire. And then we also find that all that Noah possessed, he invested it in the what? In the ark. Everything that he possessed, his material things, his life, his talents, he put it all and invested in building the ark. And then we find that Lot and his family, instead of investing, they were accumulating to sustain their lifestyle in Sodom and Gomorrah. This is exactly what we'll find in our study today. And then we also find that Noah and his family, not only that they invest all their possession, but they also use their talents and their gifts in building the ark. You remember? They use their talent and their gift, their skills in building the ark. But Lot and his family, they wasted their talents. They wasted their gifts in Sodom and Gomorrah. And we also find that all of Noah's family, this is the saddest part right here, friend. The exciting part is that Noah's family were all saved, right? They were all saved in the ark. But the sad part is that Lot's family was lost, including not only his wife. Remember that Lot had many other kids that were left in Sodom and Gomorrah, but also his two children. They were damaged. In fact, they left two tribes that would be a constant scourge to the children of Israel later on. And then we find that there was, in the days of Noah, that there was so much tremendous time to prepare before the flood. How long? 120 years. Imagine Noah and his family invested in that ark for 120 years. We're going to talk about Noah later on as well. But Lot, he only had less than 24 hours to prepare. A very extreme scenario, but yet contrasts both of these stories to tell us about relationship in the last day. We know that this is not just a warning for the world, but this is a warning to God's people in the last day. And so Jesus was telling this story to his disciples. He was telling them the end of time and what will happen just prior to his second coming. And it is important to remember, friend, that God or Jesus wasn't speaking simply to the unbelievers, but he was speaking to the believers. Let me ask you a question. Was Noah and Lot a believers and their family? Yes, they were. So he wasn't just talking about the condition of the family unit in the world, but he's talking about the condition of family unit in the church, the believers, how their life and their family would be in the last day. Two contrasts. One family was faithful, one family was unfaithful. And so this is an example in the last day. And so Jesus was giving all of this warning. And after he finished giving all of this warning, then he said in verse 32, remember who? Lot's wife. Remember Lot's wife. In warning his disciple, Jesus, instead of using Noah, a perfect family example, not so much perfect, but they were okay. They did right, right? We know that there's no such thing as perfect family. You probably know that, right? I'm learning that myself. So there's no such thing as perfect family. But Noah and his family, Jesus could have used the example of Noah. But yet, he said at the last time, verse 34, he said, remember whose wife? Lot's wife. Now, why did Jesus say Lot's wife? You know, why not just say her first name? Why did Jesus have to say, remember Lot's wife? You see, friends, Lot's wife has a name. Would you agree? In fact, Jewish tradition and scholars believe that her name was Ado or Edet. That's her name. Her name was Edet, Ado in the language. And so Lot's wife had a name. Her name was Edet. You see, friends, whenever Jesus uses words, Jesus doesn't make a mistake. He actually put it there on purpose. And so he said, remember Lot's wife. You see, friends, the reason why he has to put Lot's wife is because it will remind of Lot as well. When Jesus said, remember Lot's wife, Jesus wants us to remember not only the wife, but Mr. Lot. And by the way, friends, why did Jesus said, remember Lot's wife? You see, Jesus could have used any other woman in the Bible. Would you agree? It's because there are many virtuous women in the Bible. Jesus could have said, remember Sarah, who bare Abraham a son in her old age. Or he could have said, remember Abigail, a very gentle kind with a generous heart. Or Jesus could have used and said, remember my mother, the Virgin Mary, who were called by God as a young lady and was faithful. Jesus could have used many women in the Bible, but he said, remember who? Lot's wife. So instead, he said, remember Lot's wife. You see, friend, Jesus wants us to remember something about this story. Every time this verse pops up, every time this word comes up, we are reminded forever, not just Mrs. Lot, but we are reminded forever the husband that we need to remember. Too often we will get on that wife, right? Remember Mrs. Lot? Oh, yeah. But friends, we need to remember something about Mr. Lot. You see, remember Lot's wife. It's something that we need to remember about Mr. Lot first. Amen? You see, this story is more than about Mrs. Lot or Edith. But rather, it's about Mr. Lot. Mr. Lot, friends, has something to do with Mrs. Lot's demise that we need to remember. You see, what Jesus is trying to tell the people in the end days is that Lot had a powerful impact upon his family, either for good or for evil. So in this story, Lot has a lot to do with the decision of his wife. So the question is, what is it then that Jesus wants us to remember about Mr. Lot? All right, let's go to the book of 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 6 through 8. Notice what the Bible says. It says, turning the what? The cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemn them to destruction, making them an example to those who afterward would live what? Ungodly. And deliver righteous who? Righteous Lot, who was oppressed by the filthy conduct of the wicked. For that the righteous man dwelling among them tormented his righteous soul from day to day by seeing and hearing their what? Lawless deed. Okay? The Bible says, it tells us that Lot was what kind of man? Come on. Are you guys still there? Lot was a righteous man. He was a righteous and just man. He was so righteous and he was so faithful, it says, right, that whenever he see people sin, commit wicked ways, the Bible said that his soul was vexed, his soul was hurt. That's interesting, isn't it? Lot was a righteous man. He was called a righteous man. And his soul was tormented or vexed or hurt every time he see or in the presence of sin. So another question is, okay, is that what Jesus wants us to remember about Mr. Lot? Is that what Jesus wants us to remember about him? But you see, friends, if that is what Jesus wants us to remember about Lot, there are many other characters in the Bible who were righteous and just. There are many other people in the Bible who are righteous and just. So why Jesus didn't use them to remember? Instead, he said, remember Lot. So is the righteousness of Lot what we have to remember? Well, maybe. Maybe not, right? So what else does Jesus want us to remember? If it's not his righteousness, what else does he want us to learn about Mr. Lot? Notice now, in Genesis In Genesis chapter 19, I'm just going to give you, because we're going to go there a little bit later. It tells us about Lot. When the angels came to Sodom and Gomorrah, Lot invited them to his house. What did Lot do? He invited them to his house. He fed them, he clothed them, and entertained them in his house. So Lot was a hospitable man. Would you agree? Lot was a hospitable man. Now, not only that, but Lot was even willing to give up his own family to protect these angels from the mob. So the question is, okay, is that what Jesus wants us to remember about Lot? Well, maybe. Remember, friends, that there are many other Bible characters who are hospitable in the Bible. Amen? And Jesus could have used them as an example. So I don't think that that was what Jesus wants us to remember. Well, so the question then is, what exactly then did Jesus want us to remember about Mr. Lot that has to do with his family and his wife's demise? What was specific event? Or was there a specific time, events, and period that was so significant relating to his family and to his wife? Because remember, Lot's wife. If so, when did that happen? I want you now to turn to the book of Genesis chapter 13. Notice now, Genesis chapter 13, verse 10 through verse 12. Genesis 13, verse 10 to 12. The Bible says, are you there? You following? You can just look at the screen if you need to. It says, Lot looked up. And what did he saw? You guys following? You guys still awake? Okay. All right. So Lot looked up and saw that the whole plain of the Jordan was well watered, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt towards Zoar. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and what? Gomorrah. So Lot chose for himself the whole plain of the Jordan and set out toward the east. The two men parted company. Abraham lived in the land of Canaan, while Lot lived among the cities of the plain and pitched his tent near or toward, what? Sodom. So the Bible is telling us here that Lot chose for himself that which was more advantageous for his family and for his wealth. You see, the background to this story is that there was a fight between Lot and Abraham's servant. Do you remember the story? There was a fight that took place between Lot's servant and Abraham's servant. And as a result, they decided that it was better for them to separate ways. You remember? Are you following? So Abraham, being a gentleman, the man of God, even though he was older, and friend, it's been a custom in the Bible time that when you are older, you have the right to go first. Amen? And by the way, that is still should be a good practice in our day. Amen? You let and you respect those that are older than you. Amen? Children, young people, it's good to always respect your parents. It's good to respect your grandparents, and not just within your family, but even outside. To have. Amen? I'm taught in my culture that you got to respect those that are older than you. And so, Lot, given the first choice, he chose. Where did he choose? The plain of what? Of Jordan. Why? Because this place was the beautiful side of the land. And so Lot decided, when he first chose to go there, he said, wow, that is a beautiful place. And as a result, Lot said that he went to that direction. Why? Because this place was really a beautiful place. What is it describing? The Sodom and Gomorrah. All right? So Lot chose the best, the most advantageous place to live. That is the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. You see, friends, history records how life and culture and how advantageous it was to live in Sodom and Gomorrah. Notice Notice what the Bible tells us about the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. It says, behold, this was the what? Ezekiel 16:49. Behold, this was the what? The iniquity of thy sister Sodom. What are they? Pride. What else? Fullness of bread. What else? Abundance of idleness was in her and in her daughters. Neither did they strengthen the hand of the poor and the what? The needy. There are three things that describe what environment was like in the city of Sodom. Notice, it says, the city of Sodom, sin. These are the sins or the iniquity of Sodom. Number one is what? Pride. You see, friends, in order for them to have pride about their city, it must have been a very high-tech, well-structured, successful, advanced city. And fighting had found out that that is exactly the case. So their sin was pride. They were so happy. They were so proud of the city in which they live. It was a prosperous city. Notice what the next sin that they have. It was a what? They have fullness of what? Of bread. In other words, the economy of the great city was in good condition. They have great employment in the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. They have sustainable, and it was very ideal for prosperity. That's why they had so much. They had abundance in food. That's the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah. They had a lot. And then, what's the next one? They have abundance of what? Idleness. In other words, the city was so successful that they didn't have to work hard to gain much. They had enough. They had good investing thing going on in the city of Sodom. Their economy was in great shape. The job employment was great. And as a result, this has caused many to become idle. So this is the description of the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. In other words, it was the most attractive place to live. And as a result, Lot chose to live in Sodom and Gomorrah. You see, friends, let me just describe the city of Sodom and Gomorrah briefly to you. You see, if we are to speak of modern-day Sodom and Gomorrah is basically a description of the end of time. You see, in Sodom and Gomorrah, in their academic and their scholastic activity, they have the best university. They have the University of Sodom and Gomorrah. So people go there to get their degree, to get their master's degree and their PhD and their MD degree. So they went to Sodom and Gomorrah because it was the most advanced culture of the day. And so in Sodom and Gomorrah, they have the best athletes. They could do things and run and jump and do extreme tricks in the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. They were up to date with their fashion in Sodom and Gomorrah. In Sodom and Gomorrah, they have the latest gadgets. They have the best updates and they have the best technology in the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. Friends, as we continue, in the city of Sodom and Gomorrah, they have successful business. They have the economic center of business in Sodom and Gomorrah. Sodom and Gomorrah approve. They approve same-sex marriage and they legalize abortion. In fact, it is true. By the way, when you go into the archaeology, you find, and the Bible records, that men with men, women with women slipping together. You see, these are the condition of Sodom and Gomorrah. But yet, Sodom and Gomorrah had a downturn. The people were rich, they were well off, but they were emotionally and spiritually drained. They have no spiritual backbone. They have no moral code to define what is right and what is wrong. You see, the city of Sodom and Gomorrah was spiritually deprived. They cannot make the right choice because they are not morally upright. Friends, you know that we're not just talking about ancient city of Sodom and Gomorrah. You know that we are talking about the modern day Sodom and Gomorrah. The conditions of the place in the world that we live in. Amen? You see, friends, Lot was attracted by the lifestyle in Sodom and Gomorrah. He chose to go to Sodom and Gomorrah. But what's interesting about this is that when Abraham gave him the first choice, selection to go wherever he want, Lot chose himself the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. But friends, what's interesting is Lot did not live inside of city of Sodom and Gomorrah. Notice what it says in verse 12. It says, Abraham lived where? In the land of where? Canaan, verse 12. While Lot lived among the what? The cities of the plain and pitched his tent where? Near. Notice this. You see, Lot's mistake is that he chose the most advantageous place to go and to live. But his second mistake is that he pitched his tent near where? Sodom and Gomorrah. You see, friend, that's an interesting word because Lot did not live inside Sodom and Gomorrah, but pitched where? Outside. He pitched his tent outside of the city, not inside, because he didn't want to have the repercussion of being looked upon as partaking of the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah. You know how it is, right? You would do the same thing, but you don't want the church member or anybody else to know about your addiction, so you try to stay away, but when no one is looking, you're really close to temptation. And this is exactly what Lot was doing. He was placing himself in front of temptation. He did not live in Sodom and Gomorrah, but the Bible says that he pitched his tent what? Towards, near entrance of Sodom and Gomorrah. We're living in the last day. And friend, in the last day, it is important for us not to pitch our tent next door to where sin is. Because we know it is important to know that when you put or place yourself near temptation, you will be tempted. And this is what Lot was doing. Dazzle with visions of worldly gain. Spirit of prophecy tells us. Lot overlooked the what? The moral and spiritual evil that would be encountered there. The inhabitants of the plain were sinners before the Lord. Exceedingly, but of this he was ignorant, or knowing, give it but a little weight. He chose him all the plain of Jordan and pitched his tent toward. How little did he foresee the terrible results of that selfish choice. He didn't really intend to live in the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. He didn't wanted to live inside because that would be demoralizing to his family. But instead, he chose to live near Sodom and Gomorrah. He pitched his tent near towards Sodom and Gomorrah. And friend, that is a very dangerous thing. You see, the Bible tells us that we ought to be careful. Why? When we put ourselves close to temptation. Friends, if you're struggling with drinking, don't go to the bar. Amen. If you're struggling with smoking, don't go to the 7-Eleven and buy it. If you're struggling with pornography, don't visit the site that you shouldn't be. Have your computer, have your cell phone, somebody else help you manage. Don't put yourself in a temptation where you know there is no way out. Too often, the reason why we fall is not because we really are weak. No. You see, Spirit of Prophecy tells us that the weakest soul who is connected to Christ is stronger than anyone. In other words, friend, if you are tempted and if you allow the power and the Spirit of God to put you in the right place, He will give you the power to overcome. Amen. And too often, the reason why we fall over and over and over again, it's because we're not being accountable to anybody. If you want to overcome your addiction, if you want to overcome your sin, you got to have the help, yes, of Jesus. But friends, get some friends that you trust who won't gossip about your struggle and confide to them. Tell them, pray for my struggle. I had to do that, friends, when I was young, because I know I couldn't do it alone. I had some mentor who prayed for me. I had people who would give me advice, who would pray for me. I could be struggling that day, and I can call them, and I said, look, I am struggling, and this is hard. Please pray for me. We got to get to a point where we realize that being vulnerable doesn't mean that we don't share with people. We got to learn to share, friend, but of course, don't share with anybody who might be gossiping about you, amen? Find somebody that you trust. If your marriage is in a rocking chair, seek help. If your family is in trouble, ask a counselor. Ask someone. Pray for you. You see, friends, when we expose sin loses its power. And too often the reason why we don't ask for help is because they think that we would be looked down upon. Who cares if people look down upon me, but yet I am saved. Amen? People can put you in the pedestal, and yet you're struggling and you can be lost. So friends, I'm telling you that no matter what you may be going through in your marriage and your family, have a counselor, godly people in your life that you can confide and ask them, please pray for my family. Please pray for my marriage. We are going through a hard time. My children are not coming to church. We can't be so fake and thinking that we're, you know, faking it on Sabbath and saying we're all right when we are not. Amen? Friends, we got to have somebody. We have a friend in Jesus, but we need human friend sometimes to listen to our issues. Amen? We got to do it. This is the only way we expose sin. When sin is exposed, it loses its power. But Lot chose. He was dazzled with the advantage of worldly gain. He pitched his tent toward Sodom. But friends, if you are pitching your tent near Sodom, eventually you will be in Sodom. Many years later, someone came and invaded Sodom and Gomorrah. Someone came to Sodom and Gomorrah and took every single one captive in Sodom and Gomorrah. And remember, friends, that Lot, where did he dwell? Outside. He dwelled towards or near Sodom and Gomorrah. But when we pick up the story, many years later, we find that Lot no longer lived outside. In fact, the Bible says when they were captured, notice what it says. Genesis chapter 14 and verse 12. Okay, this invading army came. And they what? They took Lot, who dwelt outside of Sodom. Is that what it says? Where is he dwelling now this time? Who dwelt in Sodom and his good and departed. The Bible described that now Lot and his family no longer live outside. But the Bible said that they dwelt in Sodom. What did that word in mean? You're literally right there in the middle, right? So Lot and his family at first pitched their tent where? Outside. But many years later, we find that Lot and his family no longer live outside. In fact, the Bible says, Genesis 14:12, that Lot and his family now live where? Inside Sodom and Gomorrah. That's a scary thing, friend, because when you put yourself near temptation, eventually you will give in to temptation. And this is what Lot did. Not realizing how demoralizing that experience would be to his family and his children. No wonder why Jesus said, remember Lot's wife. Because when we remember the wife, we remember first who? Mr. Lot. The influence that he gave ruined his family. The location that he chose for his family ruined them morally. Yes, friends, it is important because the influence that surrounded his family was evil. Now we find his family captured and Lot is described inside. Lot's family and this city was captured. literally. But friends, not only that they were captured literally, Lot and his family was also captured spiritually. They were inside. That's exactly what's going on here. You see, friends, we have to be careful. Why? Because there is a way. The Bible said in Proverbs chapter 16, 25, there is a way which seems right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of what? The ways of death. Friends, we can't just trust our own guts. We can't just trust our own feelings. We can't just trust our own emotion. We must trust the Word of God. Amen? When making choices for the last day, we can't just say, oh, I think this is what I think is best. We got to make some inquiry from the Word of God. We got to inquire what God said, what thus saith the Lord. Because when we make choices based on how we feel, too often we will make mistakes. But if we make choices based upon God's Word and His principles, He will always guide His people in the right direction. Amen? Are you still with me this morning? You see, friends, it's important. Why? Galatians 6, 7 and 8 tells us, be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also what? He also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. You see, friends, we can't plant banana and expect that we're going to get mango. Would you agree? How many have planted an apple and then you saw the next day orange came up? The same way in spiritual life. We can't expect to sow and put our family in danger spiritually and think that they're going to be saved. We can't take the risk of doing that. That will put our family in danger. We can't expect not to have worship in the family and thinking that we still love Jesus. We can't just skip the Bible and study and prayer and think that everybody is okay. We got to make decision for the Lord. Amen? We got to make decision for the Lord. Why? Because we know that that is very important to make today. All right? So we're remembering a little bit now about Mr. Lot. But the next question is, what else does Jesus want us to remember about Mr. Lot? Notice what happened now in Genesis chapter 19. Genesis 19, 15 and 20. You remember that the angels came. Lot brought them in his house. He was a hospitable man. He brought them in his house. And when he brought them to his house, the angels finally revealed their mission. That their mission is that they had 24 or less than 24 hours to get out of Sodom and Gomorrah, or else they would be also destroyed with the city. And the angels came, and the angels did what they have to do. And as a result, now Lot and his family was being dragged by the angel. That's what literally the description is, friends. Because Lot didn't want to leave. Lot didn't want to go out of the city. It became his permanent home. Notice what it says. Genesis 19, 15 and 16. When morning dawned, the angels urged Lot, up, take your wife and your what? Two daughters who are here, or you will be what? Swept away in the punishment of the city. But what did he do? But he hesitated. So the men, notice what the men had to do, the angels. Notice what the angel had to do so the man sees what? You know what that word sees? That's a very strong word. Grab, hold it, pull them out of the city. Sometimes God has to do that to save us out of the fire of destruction. But he hesitated, so the man sees his hand and the hand of his wife and the hands of his two daughters, for the compassion of the Lord was great upon him. The angels had to literally drag Lot and his family because he was hesitant to leave the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. He was so hesitant that the angel had to do dragging them with by hand so that they can get out and be saved out of destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. So friend, Lot, he hesitated. This is why Jesus said, remember Lot's wife. Remember Lot. He was vacillating in his decision. He put his family in danger. And now he was hesitating to get out of Sodom and Gomorrah. Remember Lot. His decision in compromising in the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. Because friends, if we don't remember Lot, we will be having the same kind of end with the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. Notice what Patriarch and Prophet, page 161 says. If Lot himself manifests no hesitation to obey the angel's warning without one word of pleading or remonstrance. Notice what the next phrase. His wife also would have what? Made her escape. The influence of his example would have saved her from the sin that sealed her doom. But his hesitancy and delay caused her to light regard the divine warning. Remember Lot's. Lot's influence caused his wife to be lost. Lot's influence caused his wife to be what? To be lost. Remember Lot's wife. You see, friends, this tells us that you got to stand. Stand firm for the word. You got to be faithful to the word. Why? Because we are living in the end of time. Today, in your family, if you have been compromising, tell your wife, tell your family, I am sorry. I have not been faithful to the Lord. Please pray for me. I have not been obedient to the calling of the Lord. If you have not been the spiritual man that you are in your home, you got to make some amends and say, Lord, forgive me. And you got to ask your family to pray for you. Don't be ashamed. That's not going to make you less of a man. You see, friends, admitting your guilt, admitting your mistake, it doesn't make you less of a man. It makes you the true man that God wants you to be. Because it's only when we admit our weakness, it's only when we admit that we are wrong, it's only when we admit that we have made a big mistake can people around us give us respect. Amen. It's only then people will give you respect, knowing that you can actually take some action to do the right thing. That is very important, friends, because I know sometimes the definition of the world, what man is not the definition of the Bible. You think that when you're a man, you have big muscle, you have six-pack, and you can do all of these external things. Friend, that is not the definition of a man. The definition of a man is when you stand up for God's word, you admit that you are wrong and you do the right thing. That is the biblical definition of a man. Amen? And God called each one of us to be that person. Amen? So, what do we learn from Lot? Remember Mr. Lot. He chose comfort and overlooked the spiritual dangers for his family. Jesus said, remember this, friends, in the last day. You got to remember this because that is very, very dangerous. Number two, he placed himself near a constant temptation. Jesus is telling us, remember Lot's wife. Remember Mr. Lot in the last day. And thirdly, he was very inconsistent in doing the right thing. And so, friend, Jesus is telling us, remember Lot in the last day. The context of the last day is that he tells us, remember Lot's wife. The second part, I know we're a little bit going over here, but we're about to close. Number two, remember Lot's wife herself. Remember Mrs. Lot. Remember Edith, that's her name. Because we are forever reminded of these two people in the last day, Lot and his wife. So what lesson does Mrs. Lot tell us about the last day? You see, friends, if you're paying attention, yes, Lot had a lot to do with the example that he gave. His influence caused her to be lost, but eventually the decision was hers. Even though people influence us, yet at the same time, we got to choose ourselves. So yes, Lot was responsible, but she was responsible for her choices. So why did Jesus say, remember Lot's wife? What does Jesus exactly want us to remember? Does the verse before, remember Lot's wife, in verse 31 of Luke chapter 17, this is what Jesus wants us to remember about Lot's wife herself. Notice, it says, this is just the verse before, remember Lot's wife. It says, in that day, Luke 17, 31, in that day, he which shall be upon the what? The housetop, and his stuff in the house, let him not come down or take it away. And he that is in the field, let him likewise not return back. Two things that Jesus said, remember Lot's wife. First, when trouble comes, don't get attached to your stuff. In the last day, Jesus is warning us not to get attached to our stuff. Friends, remember that naked you came into this world, and naked in that casket you go, buried 6 feet. Amen? You are not taking nothing with you. And Jesus is telling us that when that day, the last day come, don't go back and take your stuff with you. Why? Because those are just material things. We can't take material things with us. This is why it's good to invest our material things for the purpose of building up the kingdom of God. The true investment is to invest in the kingdom of heaven. The second thing that we have to remember about Mrs. Lot is that don't turn back. Don't turn back to where you came from. You see, friends, in the last day, it is easy for us to turn back. But in the last day, God is calling us to do two things. Don't get attached to our stuff. And number two, don't look back. You see, friends, I know where I came from. And I know exactly what God had delivered me from. And He keeps delivering me from. And for me to go back to that same exact spot in my spiritual life would be a disaster to my salvation. And this is what Jesus is telling us. Don't look back. You see, Jesus is telling us today, don't get attached to the stuff. You see, friends, even though she was running out of Sodom and Gomorrah, her heart yet remained in Sodom and Gomorrah. You see, we are living in a time where people are so obsessed with possession and material things. And I want to make it clear that material things and wealth is not sin. Amen? The Bible said the love of money is sin. So it's not material itself. So let's not get attached to stuff. Because we know that in heaven there will be great material things. Like, for example, gold. You'll be walking on it. Right? So there's nothing wrong with that. But Jesus said, don't get attached to this stuff. Because today, society tells us that we need what others have. Because if we don't have what they have, we're not cool. Amen? So we look at our neighbor and we say, wow, they have the great, nice car. I'm going to get one better than that, right? And we say things like, wow, they have the nicest house. I'm going to get better than that. Friend, this is the end conditions of the world. Society also tells us that unless you have a nice body, a fit body, that you're not beautiful. Friend, that is a lie. Jesus died for you no matter what you look like, amen? Jesus didn't wait for you to be in shape. And then he died. No. He died even though we were all out of shape. Amen? And that's the good news of the gospel, because Jesus wants you and I to be faithful to his calling. You see, Mrs. Lot, even though she complied with all of the requirements, what do I mean by that? She complied as far as outward is concerned. She was running with Lot and the daughters. She was outside of the city with his family. her family. So as far as outward appearance, she was compliant. While her body was in the plain, yet her heart was still in Sodom and Gomorrah. You see, friends, this is very, very important for us to remember. Why? Because we can be outwardly compliant, but if our heart is not transformed, we are still lost. There are so many people who can be so conservative in everything that they do outwardly, but yet their heart are far from God. She went out. She went out as far as outward compliance is concerned, but her heart was still in Sodom and Gomorrah. You see, the Jewish writer, the Jewish historian, Josephus tells us that even in the day of Jesus Christ, the pillar of salt was still standing where it was, as a reminder that you don't look back. So when Jesus said, remember Lot's wife, the disciples could see this pillar of salt. And so they could still see the reminder. Don't get attached to stuff and don't look back. And so Jesus used the illustration of Lot's wife to teach us that we should not get attached to our stuff. So friends, as we bring this to a close, the lesson that we learn from Mrs. Lot is number one, don't get attached to your what? To your stuff. Stuff will just go away. Your life is more important than anything in this world. Would you agree? Number two, Jesus is reminding us that we should not turn back. Turn back what? To our previous lifestyle. To our previous addiction. Keep going. Keep going forward in God's errand. And lastly, there must be an inward change. We can't just be outwardly compliant, but yet our heart are far from God. We must have an inward change. Sometimes I notice that those people who might not get it outwardly, but yet their heart are pure. Their heart, they love Jesus in their heart. But yet they might not have it all outwardly. So friend, we cannot judge people for what they look like outside. Amen? We must look at the heart because that's how Jesus looked at people. He looked at what's inside. Not what they dress like, not what they look like, but what is in the heart. Amen? He was saved at last, speaking of Lot. But his influence and his legacy was forever marred. A legacy of two dry, of two unrighteous, idolatrous nation that was a constant enemy to God's people. Notice the last phrase. He said, how terrible were the result that followed how many steps? One unwise step. So friend, where is your heart? Where is your heart today? Because that's an important question. Where is your heart right now? Does your heart belong to this world? Or does your heart belong to Jesus? Matthew 6:21. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be what? Will be also. I challenge you today to search your hearts. To put your heart where it belongs. Not on the treasure of this world, but on the treasure above. The treasure is Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.